first road course race of the 2014 campaign will also feature the first ever standing start for a Team Master Cup Series race. Winning the Delano Pole Award, Luciano Salvarol, Carlos Requeta on the outside of the front row, two very talented South American drivers. Both young guns here. Salvarol got his first win here. Rainsford, a welcome back. Two-time series champion alongside Kevin Dwyer. All the Gesslers qualified well. Ashby and D'Souza were both quick in practice. You see Kuznetsov on the outside of row six. Great qualifying effort from both the Katsivs. And Greg Woodard running well again. Scott Bates in the 88 car, solid effort there. Melanie Clavin, who I think was looking for more in qualifying. Packer Carroll, solid effort to start 19th. And Matthias Taub in the inside of row 11, the second promoter's option is Yamino Tenshi. The car owned by Ian Cooper in the 777 car. Great effort there from Frank Azure as well. Scott Stoidler on the alert team, I think they're looking for more to start this year off. Joe Lennick in the 23 car has a great qualifying effort there. Maximus Racing having a solid effort there, given how much money they have. Tom Moore, not really a road racing background, but he's doing fairly well. Brandon Lerone, the 39 car, had some problems in qualifying, but he figured it was better to set a time. No time set by Velocity, we'll get into them later. And Danny Sauvin blew an engine right before qualifying, so he didn't take a time at all either. Now, on the pole in that black car, Luciano Salvarol in car number 5, waiting for the lights to go out. Carlos Requeta on the outside of the front row. And here we go. The lights are out and away we go. And look at it. Start by Requeta. Carlos Requeta on the 14 gets a jump on Luciano Salvarol. It looks fairly clean. Kevin Dwyer, terrible start for car number 8. Rainsford in the 27 timed it just perfectly almost. But at the 5 car in the way, Salvarol not as good of a start. But Carlos Requeta is beginning to stretch away. The young Colombian, as Rainsford hits a curb a little bit, gets squeezed out a bit by, I think, one of her teammates. All three of the Gesslers qualified very well. But there you see Requeta. That's got a Colton Morrell engine under the hood of that 14 car. He's not the lead driver for Cats of Engineering, but he is clearly showing the way here. Salvarol trying to make chase. Kevin Dwyer up to third. Rainsford has dropped back a bit in the 27 car. The champ car driver's been getting a little bit used to doing standing starts. Salvarol now, he's just going to try to... Oh, wait a minute. Salvarol slowing down. The 5 is slowing down. That looks fairly terminal, I think, if it's this early. Or maybe it's not. I don't see any smoke in the back of the car. But Salvarol definitely slowing down. I think he's going to wait for a gap in traffic. He's... Oh, look out, look out. Oh, Ian Cooper right into the back of the 5 car. I don't think that was wise on Luciano's part, but there was a gap in traffic there, but everyone else seemed to avoid him. The 777 car just piled into the back of him, but I would imagine, Cooper and Salvarol having a very loud conversation, as in the back, looks like a bit of a stack up there, as Kuznetsov and Scott Bates made contact, just a stack up there. I don't really think there's anything that could have been done about that. A very light contact sent the 15 around. And Packer Carroll involved in that big stack up right here. I'll be amazed if they get through there without any contact. In fact, I think I saw some already. We're looking right now at one of the Maximus cars. That's Kaziyama's around in the 92. Camera curse again. And the 94 Pushanda into the tires. That's one of the Maximus cars out of it. Pushanda out of it, but the 92 keeps going. Looks like Davenport may have triggered that whole mess up, but really, that was kind of inevitable. Now we got two Gesslers against the 14 Katsiv of Carlos Requeta. Requeta is going to try to hang on. That Katsiv, we think he's got a qualifying setup on because he threw a Hail Mary in qualifying, and he said he didn't really expect to be able to hold on to that in the race, but he's doing a fine job so far just to get there. Kevin Dwyer being squeezed out a bit. Arto Kekkonen. Oh, Kekkonen, is he going to thread the needle? That's a risky move. Arto Kekkonen threads the needle very early. This is on lap 2. And he squeezes right in between his teammate and Carlos Requeta, and Arto Kekkonen goes to the lead of the race. Brilliant move there by the Finn. Kevin Dwyer dives in, tries to get by his teammate, but no, the Minnesota driver not able to catch the Finn, as we got Ben Atkins and one of the two Tinos in trouble. And I think Ben Atkins is there's smoke in the back of that car. That's pretty terminal. I think Ben Atkins out of it already. Ashby in that green and gold Visit Hyrule car, crawling all over the back of Rakata's car. Oh, contact maybe a little bit. Fair contact, I'd say. As Ashby dives in, making a pass through the S like that, very risky stuff. Now Ashby in the 55, Going to stay behind Ricketta for the time being as we look at Leonard Roderick going for ninth, it looks like, on Jacob Card in the only remaining Leonard as Sabaral is out of it already after getting the pole. And, Card slipped up a bit. Roderick goes, that's Kevin Dwyer! That's Kevin Dwyer and one of the two Myasov Gesslers. There's Rainsford and the 27, his teammate. You can tell those two cars apart because the lady in red has red stripes going across her car. It's the same sponsor she has in the Champ Car Series. It's Melanie Klaveno in car number two, beginning to make some headway in the Aerotel Colt Morel. And running up, was 11th last time she crossed the stripe. In this, that's slow. Oh, Melanie's in trouble. Something broke on that car. She suddenly slowed. And then got a little bit of a tap from Rossini, and around she went into the tires and out of the race. Very disappointing for the Carbondale winner. As now we look at Ashby on Ricketta. Ashby makes the dive through the last corner, and that's why this is a better track than that piece of crap Atlanta Motor Speedway. Good thing we come here. Much better circuit here as Arto Kekkonen has pulled away from Ashby, who's now sitting in second, as you see there on the left. Devereaux in third. A pretty good start there by Axel Andersson and Yamino Tenchi. Gaspar de Souza on the 60 car has gone off the track, so that's why he has really dropped through the field. We missed that. So de Souza falling way throughout the field and all the way back to 27th, as you see. Dwyer is in the pits. Looks like they're going to get that car back on track. Velocity Motorsports has really been hemorrhaging money so far this season. There's a lot of reports that are going around that they didn't pay their tire bill for this race, and they only have one set of tires, and that was why they didn't make a qualifying effort. In fact, there's some reports that are saying that they didn't pay their tire bill at Carbondale either. There's a lot of doubt as to whether or not they're going to make it to Europe, which, given that the European Tour really starts at the fourth round of the championship, I'd say that Dan McKay and Carlos Danzello are in trouble already, as are Cameron Taylor in the 26 car, who it looks like Taylor just pulled it off to the side. It looks like it may just be a tire problem, and that's a big disappointment for Taylor because he's got a road racing background, and now he's got to go all the way around the track. Kevin Dwyer back on track in the 8 car. He's in 38th. He's a couple of laps down. And at this rate, he's just... Now, Kevin Dwyer doesn't really want to be a good lap car. He wants to go racing. I think Kevin Dwyer's out to have some fun at this point, do some bit of testing, but he wants to race with anybody, it looks like. Danny Sauvin is reporting problems with his year-old Juno already, so this car had some problems with cooling last year, but the Mitchell & Sons team fixed those problems by detuning the engines. Clearly not what Full Throttle Motorsports are doing, because they've had more problems with this 91 car than I think they probably should be having. Tom Moore in the 19 car is slow. That's one of the DeGarmo Delgado Lecoyas out of the race. So not a good weekend for DeGarmo's bunch. They lost the Team Lights race due to a penalty, and now they've lost one car in the race fairly early. Alexis Rainsford, the former two-time champion, last year's Indy 500 winner, is back. A bit rusty, perhaps, because after she has set a great qualifying effort, which is something she was not known for, is her qualifying pace. She lost a battle there with Davina Henton. A bit rusty, perhaps, on return. Benoit Vukler in the 42 car is throwing the dice on pit strategy. He's already pitted back to 35th place. Get some clean running there for the Tutino. As Adrian Devereaux now begins to set up Carlos Ricketta to have a run on the young Colombian, the Frenchman, the two-time series champion. Gets around Ricketta. Not too much of a problem there. Adrian Devereaux and Carlos Ricketta, friendly competitors on track. Devereaux is clearing Ricketta now in that 14 car. But that Devereaux in that 7 Haas manufacturing call. Oh, wait a minute. Devereaux is slowing down a bit. Oh, Devereaux is slowing, and I think maybe it's coming onto one of the longest straights here at Road Atlanta, so I would imagine he may have having a transmission problem. With that car, that would just be a guess, but Adrian Devereaux pulls it to a stop, and he climbed out of that car and just disgustedly walked away from it. So Yulianna Sova now is going to be the next driver to challenge Carlos Ricketta for third. Here's an interesting battle. Ike Durbin versus Chris Davenport for 24th place. And these two guys have not been playing nice with each other. Davenport's having a pretty good start, but he hasn't had anything too complimentary to say about Ike Durbin. Durbin, in the meantime, is driving for Terra International Motorsports here, and he's got the same engines that Luciano Savaral, Jacob Card have, and also that Power Steering Incorporated and the DeGarmo boys have. So Ike Durbin's got a pretty good piece here with that the Helsing car there. Matthias Taub is being patient with not only Wernström, but with this race, it looks like, because he's slowly making progress. He's up to 21st. In car number 21, Taub said he's not disheartened with the pace of the Wernström so far this year. He has told us, he said, just wait till later in the year, we'll be better then. But it's a building process, and we have to gel this team together, and we have to build this team up. So Taub, being the optimist and being the cheerleader, which is what Melrose Racing team definitely needs. Lap 12, you have Jenny Kuznetsov pitting. I think Katsov saw what time is Benoit Vukler is doing on track, and I think maybe better to pit Kuznetsov now. Axel Andersson in car number 74 is the surprise ticket of the year. Not to throw Andersson under the bus, because he's certainly a very talented driver. Locked up the TM Lights title last year, the race to go, but it's that the Michelin Suns didn't exactly have the most promising year last year, and coming into this year, they didn't look so hot, so see Andersson doing so well. Uh-oh. Scott Bates cut tire there, but as I was saying about Andersson, it was surprised to see that 74 car running as well as it has. But Scott Bates cut tire, he's going to bring that thing into the pits. Definitely some lost ground for the 88 car, which is a bit disappointing. Yulia Nasova's finally closed in on the 14 car, but Roquette has made that car awfully wide to keep Nasova and that Gessler-powered Lynx car at bay. Roderick beginning to show up in the mirrors there. Nasova has a run on Roquette going through the S. This could be risky stuff. Carlos Roquette, maybe a bit wide onto the curbs. Nasova's going to be side-by-side with him going through the S's. This could end in tears, but Nasova clears him. Great move by the Russian. Nasova now around Roquette in that 14 car. Nasova in car number 10 trying to pull away a bit as we're looking at Jacob Card pitting the Lennard. Card was going to run Scott Hamilton's helmet that he ran for so much of his career, but it got stolen from the paddock, actually. So Card now running his usual black and yellow helmet design as opposed to that tropical beach setting as depicted on Hamilton's helmet as Nasova slows down in the front straight just a lap after she got around Roquette, and Roquette's going to take a spot back. Carlos Roquette has got to be one of the luckiest men here because he's regained a couple of positions just through other cars blowing up that have just recently passed him, as both Velocity cars were Dan McKay in the blue car, Carlos Denzel in the black car have been lapped, and they're being far more courteous than they have been previously in the year. Although to say it is entirely the fault of Dan McKay and Carlos Donzello would not exactly be the fairest thing to do, because that is probably the most evil handling car I've seen in some time. As Arto Kekkonen now going to lap Benoit Vukler. Vukler squeezes Kekkonen out, but it looked like Kekkonen was slowing anyway. Yes, Kekkonen was slowing down anyway, so he was, yes, Kekkonen may have been waving Vukler by. Kekkonen's got a massive lead at this point, so he hasn't exactly been pushing this 9 car all that much. Not Ashby in on the same lap, and Roquette and Roderick are in, so it looks like everybody's coming in at the same time. Davina Hinton in the 11 car. Davina Hinton has had somewhat of a reputation for being able to create fuel. You can tell the Lynx car is apart, by the way, by the front valence dam and the rear spoiler. Dan McKay in the 360 car. The Velocity cars haven't pitted yet. They're running a lot slower than usual, maybe, to stretch their fuel for... Oh, Chris Johann's out of it in the 12 car. It's a disastrous start of the year for Alert. It's amazing to believe that this team has fallen as far as it has. They won the title last year. No points for, so far anyways, on the board for them. And, it looks like Donzello pitted, but he only took fuel on board. And, they didn't put tires in this 180 car. Fuel only stopped. It's kind of mindless, but, here's why! Hang on to it! Oh, he's throwing it off into the sand pit! And Carlos Donzello is going to park that car over there and climb out of it. I think he's had enough. Dan McKay in the 360 car is still running around out there, but I do believe McKay is being called into the pits because I think he may have a tire going down. And if that's the case, that'll be the end of the race for McKay in the car number... Danny Sauvin being called in as well. Looks like there's a display of vapor at the back of that car. Fluid leak, as the graphic said. So the Rockstar is going to bring the 91 car in, and I think they're going to go to work on that thing, but I doubt they're going to get it back out there. It's Cameron Taylor in the 26 car being a very courteous lap car to Chris Davenport. Oh, Ike Durbin into the back of him, and wow, Ike Durbin just jacked up Cameron Taylor and punted him off the course. We're halfway now, halfway through this race, and Arto Kekkonen's got a very solid lead, and Ashby very solidly in second. I think the battle for first and second more or less resolved, but now it looks like it's going to be Jacob Carr trying to chase down Carlos Urquiza. Still a fantastic race so far. Oh, wow, that was Donzello slow on the side of the track. Guess he didn't climb out of it after all. I guess he's going to slowly wheel it back to the pits because he doesn't feel comfortable with it. Anyways... Davenport will have a new sponsor after this race. Dilpair was only on this car for the first three races, so we will see a new sponsor on the 84 car, and hopefully a new paint job, because that shade of red is frankly abysmal. Battle for fifth place, as we see Davina Hinton and Leonid Roderick. Hinton, a little bit wide. Roderick in the orange number four, those blue wheels, which I kind of like. He's going to be chasing Hinton down. Davina Hinton and Yulia Nasova's cars can be distinguished from each other from the front of the front valance on those cars and the rear spoil. Oh no, Azure! If he's smoking that much, then that means that's an engine done. Very disappointing for Frank Azure, who was having a fantastic day so far. Didn't really get to mention it, but the TV graphics certainly caught it. He was running up in 11th, so big disappointment for FAC Motorsports. Something usually goes wrong with them anyway, and it's usually none of their doing. One of the hardest luck teams in motorsports is Leonid Roderick takes the position away from Hinton. As we go back to Craig Mummer in that white, blue, and red car, there he is, the 114 car. He's doing battle at Matthias Tab now for, I think, 14th place. Mummer in this Omeka setting up Taub. Great run, and interesting thing with the number they're doing on that car, but he sweeps around Taub right past the start-finish line. Now we go to Alexis Rainsford versus Alessandro Rossini for 8th. Rossini is driving Rainsford's old ride from a couple years ago, and Rainsford in that 27 car. Been very congratulatory of the young Italian. Whoa, Rossini diving that thing in and trying to make it stick, and it looks like he does around the outside, clears it beforehand. I think Rainsford may have let him go because I don't think that 27 car is quite handling the way she... Oh yeah, Rainsford definitely let him go because she... that car is not handling as well as I think she would like. And Gaspar Souza is back up to 20th in the 60 car in the Clapper TV car. Car that distinctive teal and black livery. He's running back at 20th. He's trying to set up Kuznetsov in the second Katsev. D'Souza, no, looks like he's going to apply the pressure. But the Arto Kekkonen is behind him. Is that next car behind him? Here is Yamino Tenchi in car number 25, running up in 11th. The Clockwork Midnight having a pretty good run, and that is Lewis Kingston running up in 12th. So, the Manicorn Emoto having a solid day as well. Jacob Carr and Leonid Roderick are having a battle now for 4th. Roderick just flying through this field right now in car number 4, so Leonid Roderick definitely making things interesting here, as he so often does. There's a reason why he's a 4-time champion. He's not really the kind of driver to sit there. Oh, Carr a bit wider. Roderick just going to poke his nose in there and try to take the position any way he can. Squeeze his car out a little bit. Roderick through. No, not quite. Not quite. Roderick slid it a bit, but I think he's going to be able to clear Carr. Carr trying to squeeze him out wide. I don't think that's going to work. No, Roderick was already there, and he clears Carr around the outside there. Great move by Roderick. Azuma Kazuyama running in the points in the Maximus car. Maximus Racing might need these points just to finish out the year because, kind of like Velocity Motorsports, they're not doing that well financially either. But Maximus, a little bit more secure than Velocity. And not only that, the Maximus car is on the pace, so it's going to be a lot easier for Maximus to acquire sponsors as Scott Stoiler pits the 13 car off cycle. I think he's got a cut tire on that thing. Having a good day. Oh, no, that is a scheduled stop. Oh, Ricketta's hit the pit wall. Ricketta kisses the pit wall. I think he got away with that. I don't see any real serious marks on that car. And here is Ricketta now leaving the pits in that 14 car. Pulling it back onto the track. That's Kingston turns him! Kingston turns him! Ricketta slow spins it! And he saves it! And he saves it! Tenshi paying attention there. But Ricketta got turned, brought it around, and saved it. Let's have another look at that as he leaves the pits. There's the 17 car. Ricketta merged right in front of Kingston. Kingston turned the 14, had none of that. That pit exit has been fairly controversial, but what a save by Carlos Ricketta as Arto Kekkonen pits the 9. Gets Joel Lenick the pit with him. Ah! Ashby staying out a bit longer. No one told Ashby that Arto Kekkonen is over 20 seconds up the road because Ashby staying out longer, possibly to defend that from Roderick in the 4, who is Packer Carroll in trouble, but Ashby might be trying to defend that position from Roderick, who is absolutely flying through this field right now. But Packer Carroll and the Mana Cornamoto out of it, and he was having a solid day, so that's a big disappointment for Packer, who just can't find any luck this year. Arto Kekkonen now, he's going to lap Mike Durbin. I don't know what I was thinking there. Those cars look very different from each other. That 58 car, Mike Durbin, the Terry International Motorsports car. That's not Ricketta behind Arto Kekkonen. That is the 15 of Kuznetsov. Oh, no! No! Kekkonen was turned by a lapped car! Mike Durbin just hooked and turned the race leader. Oh, there's no reason for that. As you were on board with Kuznetsov, who had just been lapped. Kuznetsov taking it easy. Kekkonen had cleared the 58 by this point, but Mike Durbin just runs right into the back of him. That Mike Durbin just was not paying attention. I don't, either that or he's got some grudge with Kekkonen that we don't know about, because there was no reason for that at all. Durbin has not exactly been making many friends on track. Davenport's already complained about him, and well, Davenport complains about a lot of people anyway, but so you can take that with a grain of salt. But Mike Durbin, that was an uncalled for maneuver there. And I don't see any, he's now getting in Kevin Dwyer's way, and no, he's cutting off Kevin Dwyer too. Not racing him for position either. Anyways, this is going to put Zelda Ashby in the lead of the race, Mike Durbin in the 58 car. He'll probably be investigated for that later, but I don't see any notification of that right now. Granted, we haven't seen any penalties being thrown out today, which is a little interesting, but Ashby in that 55 car is going to inherit the lead of the race, and Leonard Roderick is a long ways back from Ashby, but Roderick is the fastest car on the racetrack, so Ashby may not entirely be safe, but Roderick is definitely trying to close the gap. Is Ashby now behind a gaggle? There's Ike Durbin up ahead. Be careful. There's that 21 car, it's Matthias Taub, that yellow and red car. And Craig Mummert is that white car up the road. Taub is much more courteous back marker, usually, on that the MRT car. But he's racing Mummert for position. Yeah, Taub's going to let the 55 go. Looks like gives Ashby some room. Ashby goes around the outside. He's got to go around the outside there to clear the 21 car. Going to get held up a bit by 50. Somehow has it been pitted. Has a pitter been black? Oh, Ike Durbin actually courteous. Wow. And now Ashby going to go around Craig Mummert in the 114 car. And Mummert hits the curve. No! That's the second time today. The leader's been wiped out. Oh, no. Ashby's keeping it going. Roderick not in sight. Ashby can still hang on to the lead. If Ashby rejoins quickly enough, Ashby retains the lead after getting nerfed off the road by Mummert. Yeah, saw that coming. Craig Mummert in the 114 car gets a time penalty, but honestly, I don't think that's going to affect his running position anything. Kurt Pliskin is running up in just in the points in the Power Sting Incorporated like Koya. I wonder if that's the same problem Luciano had, because they do share quite a bit of information between Pliskin and the Factory Leonard team, the Power Sting Incorporated bunch, as Jacob Card having a run at Carlos Ricketta for the final podium spot. card in that six car. He's had an interesting weekend already, but Rikketta holding him off. Now, Rikketta's making this Rookie of the Year battle very, very interesting. Both these guys are competing for Rookie of the Year. Card in that six car. Oh, Rikketta's wide! Card goes going to go through in the air. Rikketta's squeezing him a bit. Card and Rikketta not exactly racing each other. Oh, Card clears Rikketta. Jacob Card up to third, but Rikketta trying to keep him honest as Scott Stoidler, his day is done. He was running in a fine 11th place, but unfortunately, Alert's going to go to the European Tour with no points so far, and that's surprising. Greg Woodard and Lewis Kingston are doing battle for 8th place. Greg Woodard and Kingston, these are two guys that are going to race each other cleanly, because I know if there's one driver you're not exactly going to want to get on the wrong side of, it's that 17 car. Kingston, they don't call him the Avenger for nothing, as Kingston hangs on, squeezes Woodard off the back, off the track a little bit as we look off the back bumper of Ashby. And yes, you see that orange car, that's Roderick. That white car is Mummert. Mummert did eventually let Ashby go cleanly. Mummert's one of the most courteous guys off the racetrack, one of the nicest gentlemen off the track, but on the track, different story. It seems to be. He had problems with Adrian Devereaux last year in Wales. Leonard Roderick now closing in on Craig Mummert. Roderick, if he clears Mummert quickly enough, could have a run at Ashby and make this an interesting battle for the win. Mummert holds the four up. No, Mummert not moving out of the way. I think Mummert may figure better to let Roderick go by anywhere but there. No, Mummert hasn't moved over yet. Oh, Jacob Card in trouble. Jacob Card in trouble. The six car slowing with just a couple laps to go. Roderick, no. Craig Mummert squeezing Roderick out. Mummert not paying attention. What are mirrors? What are mirrors, people? Roderick losing tons of time because of Mummert here. He's not really going to have any chance to have a run on Zelda Ashby, who is going to run away from Leonard Roderick and take home the win here at Road Atlanta in a very fine victory for Ashby. Roderick settled for second, but he wasn't very happy about it, the way Mummert was racing in his post-race interview. Rikketta third, the luckiest podium finisher I think probably ever. I don't know how many people passed him only to conk out just moments afterwards. Andersen fourth, Rossini a top five finish. Rainsford with the promoter's option brings it up to sixth. Kingston, Kuznetsov, Woodard, and D'Souza round at the top 10. D'Souza had to fight through the field to get that. And round of applause to Yamino Tenshi, Joe Olenek, and Matthias Taub. Cars we didn't expect to finish that well did. Peter Short as well. Both Melrose cars in the top 15. And you got Kazuyama in 15th place as well, and that's going to really help him and that team in the long term. Craig Mummert's time penalty did absolutely nothing to him. Which really wasn't a surprise. Brandon Laurent, the 39 car, should also be given a round of applause for bringing that car up to 17th place. I think really what Laurent needed to do was just survive, and he did. Ike Durbin, not exactly the paddock's most popular driver. Benoit Vogler and Chris Davenport round out the points finishers. If there is a harsher penalty thrown at Ike Durbin, Jacob Card might actually get the final point, despite not actually finishing the race. So, and let's just say I'd like to be a fly on the wall for that post-race stewards meeting. And let's have a look at the Drivers' Championship. Because Adrian Devereaux didn't finish the race, Alessandro Rossini seized the opportunity with both hands and takes over the championship lead. Talk about making the most of your opportunities. Goes over to Volpi and immediately fast right out of the box. The Italian definitely proving what a lot of people saw last year. Leonard Roderick said to expect Rossini to be fast and for him to be a tough teammate to beat. So far, that is proving to be the case. Rossini, solid and smooth. He's leads the championship. Adrian Devereaux and Ashby second and third. Roderick fourth. Axel Andersen's hanging in there. Fifth in the championship after only three races, but still a monumental effort there. Kekkonen, Woodard, solid efforts there. Melanie Klevenow's win at Carbondale is where most, pretty much all her points come from. Carlos Rikketta and Lewis Kingston ran on the top 10. Championship is still wide open. Anyone in the top 20 that's a full-timer really could still have a legitimate shot at winning the championship. But there's also some guys that you don't see here. Scott Bates, maybe, who hasn't had the greatest start to the year, but that 88 car is fast. Gasper D'Souza, the 60 car could still have a run at it. We're three races in, the championship far from decided. And with a series of road races and the European Tour coming up, that could certainly make things interesting. But now let's have a look at how the Independence Trophy looks after three races. Mike Durbin leads the Independence Trophy for the time being. Ryan Matthews second, Messina, Mummert, Hall, rounding out the top five there, but we still have plenty of races to go. Anthony Griffith did start Carbondale, but it wasn't as an independent, so he gets no points for that, obviously. But it's still very early to predict the Independence Trophy winner, especially now that special events count towards the Independence Trophy as well. That being said, the next time we'll see the Master Cup Series in action will be the first race of the European Tour in England.